Robbie the Van.
Andrew Morin.
This is Fez.
Hey, I'm Alex Fajardo.
Jeremy Reese, over and out.
Imagine Chanel.
Matt Healy.
Mike Spellman.
David Katz.
Mr. Becky, and can you handle this?
This is Mr. Banks. I believe your modifier is dangling.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Miss Kim. I'm the dance team advisor. Tonight is Mr. FHS.
Mr. FHS is huge.
This is gonna be so ill.
Everyone is going.
This is a huge deal. Everyone needs to come. This is gonna be the best Mr. FHS ever.
Mr. FHS is one of the biggest events of the year. Everybody goes to it and it's well looked forward to. Here's a clip from the opening act on March 18th. You can see the contestants expertly perform this dance, but no one really knows how much work they put into it. It took days of practice and many hours.
Well, it took them a really long time to learn a dance.
But at the end of it, they learned it somehow, right?
I mean, at the end of it, it looks funnier if they don't know it very well, so.
Preparation. To be honest, very honest, I started preparing this since last year. So after the night show 2008, I sat down, did the pros and cons, and I started evaluating everything. From then, I've been thinking about all these great ideas and what could we do here, what could we do better, or what to keep.
A lot of hours, like 10 or like 12 hours of just continuous work.
Probably half an hour, give or take.
Since I was 6 years old.
Hours. I would say a minimum of, and I don't speak in hyperbole here, maybe 50. 50 to 60. And by 50 to 60, I mean 1 to 2.
Honestly, I've been actually singing my song for like days.
I've been with everybody practicing for a couple days now. I've been practicing nonstop at my house.
So, practicing for a few days. It's pretty intense and, you know, it's not just about movement. It's about, you know, smell and taste, and right now I would kind of consider myself kind of like a dance biscuit. Does that make sense? You know, taste, dance, biscuit.
The hardest part for me, obviously, is definitely the dance moves, because I do not have the workout etiquette to do them. I don't even know if that's the right word to use.
So remembering my lines, remembering my lyrics is pretty tough too. You know, I'll improv. It'll be good.
Maybe, I don't know, Miss Kim kind of overworked us maybe sometimes. Yeah.
Hardest part was Miss Kim. Just like honest all the time.
Make me look at you, not Healy. Make me look at you. Yes, make me look at you. You have to count to three. Now go off stage. Go.
And she's watching me right now, so I'm not going to say anything bad.
Memorizing what I had to say on such short notice, because I kind of just finished like the second verse of my song today. But, you know, got it. I got it. It's going to be good.
Yo, shimmy, shimmy, y'all, shimmy, yam, shimmy, yay. Give me the mic so I can take it away. We're going to jam here from the home of the Flyers, Framingham.
The hardest part for me was I'm good at everything.
Nothing.
This is all easy.
Don't phase me. Can I say shit on
me? No, you can't.
This is what I was born to do.
Nothing was really hard. I'm pretty much awesome at everything I've ever done.
Accepting the fact that I have a big butt, and apparently that doesn't help in the movement of the hips.
By the end of the week, everyone was tired and tensions were high.
This is how we deal with stress. We dance around.
If you are what you say.
You got it, guys. Do your best. Pass it. Straight. There we go. Let's be Britney.
If you are what you
the general public really doesn't know what we do unless they're around us a lot. I heard someone describe one time what we do, what I do for a living is we're ordinary people that do an extraordinary job.
When you think of a firefighter, what do you see?
There are many heroes around the world, but this is the story of the men and women of Engine 3.
Hi, I'm Mike Sullivan, Lieutenant, Lowell Fire Department. I'm assigned to the rescue truck.
What's your name? Ryan Carroll. Very good.
29. 29. Richard Lavasser. I've been on the Lowell Fire Department for 27 years.
27.
Over there you got Liz.
37 plus 30.
Sit up.
Liz Morales. 8 years.
The first person you worked with was whom?
Michael Silva. He wasn't a lieutenant back then.
But he was a
nice guy. He was lazy.
But he was a nice guy.
Oh, he showed out. Fire at the firehouse.
This flames about this high. We get bigger as the moment, right? The moment.
All these men and women became firefighters for a reason.
Right. Because I was born.
He was born to be firefighters. Mine's generational as well. Yep. His dad's a firefighter.
And my grandfather.
Third generation.
It's Engine 6, you've heard him go out on a couple of calls. It was in their section of town, so we were on Engine 6, and we're the first ones to the fire. Engine 3 coming out of here, so it's about a mile away, maybe, whatever. Yeah. But they're second in, so, and it's like, whoever can put the water on the fire first is, you know, it becomes their fire, and they're the ones who get the credit for putting the fire out. We can be there for 3 days, 200 firefighters, but that first engine will claim it was their fire, and they put the fire out. So,
well, now I drive Engine 3. I am the
bomber. Even though it seems that all they do is fool around, when that bell hits, it's all business.
The thing with the fire department, fire station, is we do have a rank structure like the military does. And when the bell hits, that rank structure is definitely followed like the military is, like a military order.
169 Aiken Ave, I think.
169 Aiken Ave.
Does the rescue go?
Thankfully, it wasn't a fire like the one we saw on 9/11, but nonetheless, the firefighters have no idea what to expect when they come back from a fire.
But as the years go by, it's the job, and that you do the job.
No matter what the consequences or what the stakes are, these men and women put their lives on the line just for you.
And I love what I do. I can honestly say that the 27 years that I've been on the fire department, I really have never regretted coming into work.
I happen to get along with, most people here get along with everybody. So the 40 some odd people that are on duty right now, I'm not sure how many it is, but I get along with everybody. In this house, we all get along great. It's
fantastic.
until about 8 years ago, I had a mother who could take care of me, and she was someone that I always sought counsel with. And she was someone who was strong and very much a feminist, and she began her slow and kind of painful descent into Alzheimer's, and little by little, it would steal bits and pieces of her and her personality and who she was, and she knew who we were less and less. And the roles began to reverse, and then we end up taking care of her, and you still see little glimpses, bits and pieces of who she was.
I remember that. Yeah. It was a friend of hers?
Hmm.
Oh, and he's such a cute little guy, isn't he? He is. Absolutely.
The most difficult part for me of my grandma having Alzheimer's is seeing how it affects my mom, and sometimes when we go to visit her, or my grandma, after we visit her, my mom she's, you know, visibly upset. She will walk out and she'll start tearing up, and just seeing that, how it affects her it's different than how it affects me, because I never really knew grandma before she had it, but my mom did, and just seeing for my mom how she was, you know, my grandma was she was a motherly figure to her. She was her mother, and just seeing how she can go from being a mother to sometimes it's just hard for her, because she really doesn't I really don't understand what that's like, because I've never really, you know, I've always had my mom with me, and she always, you know, she can always do things for me, but my grandma really can't do anything for my mom anymore.
Alzheimer's disease is a progressive degenerative disorder that attacks the brain and results in disorientation with impaired memory, thinking, and judgment. People with Alzheimer's also undergo changes in their behavior. This combination of symptoms is also called dementia. Symptoms of Alzheimer's disease can include gradual memory loss, decline in ability to perform routine tasks, disorientation, difficulty in learning, loss in language skills, impairment of judgment, and personality changes. Alzheimer's disease begins slowly. The first symptoms may only be mild forgetfulness. As the disease progresses, symptoms become more noticeable. There is no cure available for Alzheimer's disease, but two FDA-approved drugs used to treat Alzheimer's disease are tacrine and donepezil. Both of these drugs help maintain levels of the brain chemical acetylcholine, which is produced at much lower levels in people with Alzheimer's disease. Symptoms for Alzheimer's disease can also be caused by other conditions, some of which are treatable. These include thyroid gland problems, drug reactions, and severe depression. No single test exists to diagnose Alzheimer's disease, but a series of tests can rule out other illnesses and help doctors make their diagnosis.
I think one of the aspects of Alzheimer's that I certainly didn't expect was the effect that it would have on not just myself personally with my mother, but my brothers and sisters. We find ourselves obviously trying to deal with this disease, and it's unlike a course of action where someone has cancer, they go through a certain treatment. Alzheimer's, it has a varying courses you can take, and of course everybody in the family wants to do their best and get their two cents in to decide on what they think is the best treatment to take. And the problem is everybody wants to do what's best for my mother, but we find ourselves being at odds sometimes over what is the best thing. And it's difficult because I come from a very close family, and we're not usually at odds at all, but we've come to some pretty good arguments over the last...
Although Alzheimer's affects 5.2 million people in the U.S., the individual effects on families are endless, and this is just one family story.
¶¶
nearly a student body of 2,200 kids, Framingham High School is one of the largest high schools in the state and only growing larger. Over recent years, national bullying rates have also been on the rise, and this is no surprise due to the number of bullies being portrayed in movies, as well as the recent boom in technology available to students. From instant messaging clients such as AIM or MSN to social networking clients such as Facebook, cell phones in the pockets of every teenager across America don't help either, but bullying is quite quickly becoming an epidemic that has no easy cure.
Yes, I definitely think that bullying is influenced now by Facebook. Even though I don't have one, I have seen a lot of things happening with Facebook now. When I was in school, it was more the face-to-face, you know, the bully would, you know, be calling names or, you know, giving a kid a hard time. But now with, you know, Facebook, people can put things on there. You have cyberbullying. Where, you know, people can call people names or be really, really mean and just awful to other people on this new site that we have now. So I think it definitely is a big problem, and, you know, they can be traced now, which is a good thing, but I still think something needs to be done so some kid isn't being bullied on this Facebook that we now have that's supposed to be so great.
Bullying, very bad thing, very destructive. Generally, it's the act of someone trying to assert some sort of dominance or superiority over someone at the expense of that person. It's very harmful, hurts people's self-esteem. And I think injures people emotionally in ways that we can't see for, that are not so always very obvious. If someone's bullied, I think they, it's very difficult, but need to find someone within the building that they can confide in and inform the person that they're being bullied or hurt, and that the faculty or administration or adult in the building needs to take action and put a stop to it. It's very destructive. It happens a lot, unfortunately. And usually I've found in my role as a social worker that those who bully are usually feeling really inferior themselves, and it's a way, it's kind of a superficial way for them to feel powerful and strong.
In a recent independent study conducted at FHS, it was found that 3/4 of students have been bullied during their time at the high school, and over 1/6 were bullied on a weekly basis. A surprising number admitted to being and having been bullied online, as well as spreading gossip about each other.
I remember back in middle school, kids used to have a nickname for me. It started with fat, because they all thought I was fat. And, sorry, hold on a second. I really didn't like it. It didn't make me feel good about myself. It made me feel fat. And thus, every time I looked in the mirror, I didn't like what I saw. And so yeah, I really didn't like it. Bullying's bad.
I have been hurt by bullying.
I have been hurt by bullying. I have been hurt.
I've been hurt by bullying.
I have 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 been very hurt by bullying.
I have been hurt by bullying.
I have
been hurt by bullying.
I have been hurt by bullying.
I have been hurt by bullying.
I have been hurt by bullying.
I have been hurt by bullying.
I have been hurt by bullying.
I've been hurt by bullying.
I have been hurt by bullying.
I've been hurt by bullies.
We have been hurt by bullies.
We have been hurt by bullying.
I have been hurt by bullying.
We have been hurt by bullying.
I've been hurt by bullying.
Well, FHS is a strong community. Things need to change. We can't continue this vicious cycle. We must put an end to this horrific epidemic that plagues our hallways, and once again, become one unified community.
With the new after-school rules here at the high school, the Wellness Center has now become more than just a place to go to get in shape. It's also become a great place to go after school to hang out for an after-school activity. With state-of-the-art equipment and trainers who really know what they're doing, the Wellness Center is guaranteed to give you a great workout and will help you stay in shape.
Center is run by Mr. Mike Basante. He believes that to have good health and good fitness, it is necessary to come to the Wellness Center. He also believes that coming to the Wellness Center after school is a great place to go to hang out with your friends for an after-school activity.
It's extremely important to come into the Wellness Center, both for health, fitness, muscular, strengthening your muscles, and a good place to come after school for an after-school activity.
In addition to the students and faculty, student athletes also use the Wellness Center in training for their sports. I was able to talk to Jeremy Reese and Nils Olsen, two student athletes here at the high school, to get their thoughts on the Wellness Center.
So I wrestle for the high school, and we spend a lot of time in here running, lifting, and stuff because we have these facilities here. We might as well use them. We come in here for morning lifts all the time during the fall, and it's pretty cool to have stuff this good. Having a wellness center in the school and it being free, it gets rid of all the hassle of having to go work out, makes you want to work out more, and in turn makes you a better athlete.
Tanner Garino is a three-sport athlete here at the high school. She explains how the Wellness Center helps her team prepare for their seasons and also brings her teams closer together.
Okay, well, the gym helps like bring the team together when we all go in there and work out, and it strengthens our team and makes everyone stronger and faster. It's just a good place to go when you play sports.
I think having a gym helps them in a number of ways. I think number one, it gets them the easier access into the gym, so they're more willing to come down. I think more importantly, it teaches them life stuff, getting in shape, staying in shape. You see kids after season when they're senior still working out. And I think there's a certain amount of camaraderie that comes into having a gym and having kids work out hard and being together and feeling like they're doing something positive together. So I think it's huge. We're lucky to have this center right in the building.
All right, the Wellness Center is open from 2 to 4 for students and staff. It's open between 4 and 6 for athletes. And then it's open Monday through Thursday from 6 to 8 p.m. for the community members. For community members, we're open Monday through Thursday from 6 to 8 p.m. It's $20 per month. And all you have to do is come into the Wellness Center, or you can give me a call, and I'll be more than happy to set you up.
If you're hesitant to work out because you don't know how to use the equipment or you haven't worked out much before, don't worry. Coach Basante will help you and teach you everything you need to know. For now, this is Matt Bradley reporting for Flyer News.
16 years old, this is the sacred age when Massachusetts teens are brought out of childhood and given the responsibility to drive a car. This liberating and rewarding opportunity is an overwhelming experience for any young driver. To find out more, we interviewed some FHS teens who have yet to start to drive and some who are currently driving.
My name's Abdullah Mansour.
My name's Diana Stefano.
Jenna Stefano.
Zach Billings.
Joseph J. Hansberry.
I'm 15 and a half.
I'm 16.
I'm 18.
I'm not excited for driver's ed because I heard it was really boring, but I'm excited to drive.
I was able to start driving on March 18th, but what happened was it was so booked that I have to wait a month now to get my license.
Well, I have my permit now, but I'm starting driver's ed in like a month.
I've been driving for about 2 months now.
2 years? Something like that?
Well, I get my permit in 6 months, and then a year from now, I'll have my license, hopefully.
Have I ever been in an accident? The answer would be no, I have not.
Joe may not have been in an accident yet, but thousands have. In fact, roughly 5,000 drivers under 20 will die from fatal car accidents this year, due in no small part to avoidable distractions on the road that teens are most susceptible to. Eating, drinking, talking on the phone, and changing the radio station are all dangerous things to do when driving with other people on the road.
My mom is really worried for me to drive. Like, whenever I drive with her, and I do something wrong, she always grabs the wheel and forcefully, turns the car. And I'm gonna have, a curfew, and she's not gonna have me, she's not gonna let me drive my friends for a while, and she's just gonna be really strict about it.
Probably. They don't tell me that they're worried, but I bet you they are.
I drove people before I could.
I drive with one hand, I don't drive with two.
My dad's been letting me drive here and there for a while, for a few years, so I can drive.
I only broke curfew once and it was actually by accident.
And I drive with no shoes on.
The speed limit is 30 miles an hour and I just say that's ridiculously slow. So no, I don't speed. I exceed the speed limit. If that makes sense.
Speeding. I love my radar detector. I love it. Never hit 100, if that helps.
I pay for everything. Everything.
I think my parents are gonna pay for the insurance, but I might have to pay for the gas.
I'm a hardworking man. 40 hours a week, Dunkin' Donuts. Get at me.
I pay for gas sometimes because I am not a spoiled Northsider.
I pay for gas when I use the car. I don't pay for insurance yet.
My parents have?
Yeah.
Well, my dad has a big Ford truck and my mom has a little Camry.
He has a Jeep Liberty.
Don't. I do drive my mother's gold minivan and or station wagon.
A Ford Tempo 1993 or 2. Forest green. Cowboy seat covers and floor mats. And a trunk that could fit 10 dead bodies.
When I have my license, I'm just gonna drive everywhere. I'm gonna drive my brother wherever he needs to go. I'm gonna drive, hang out with my friends. It's gonna be fun.
I'm very excited for driving. I hate having to ask my parents to take me places or having to find a ride with someone else. It's so annoying.
April vacation, I decided that I'm gonna go on a road trip with a couple of friends, but I don't know where I'm going yet. I'm just out somewhere to the wilderness.
I think I might just drive everywhere. I'll just waste gas driving everywhere. I don't even care.
Yes, gotten one ticket, been pulled over 4 times.
Today I am at the Crown Plaza Hotel where Relay for Life is hosting a fashion show to benefit the American Cancer Society. All of the money raised will go to cancer research and helping cancer patients. All the models at the fashion show are cancer survivors, and today it was a great success. So let's take a look at what everyone was wearing. The fashion show took place at the Crown Plaza Hotel in Natick. Backstage, the models had their hair and makeup done, while a brunch and silent auction took place to raise money for the American Cancer Society. Then the audience moved to the Plaza Ballroom, where the models showed off their fashionable outfits. MC Susan Warnick provided entertainment with her sense of humor and concluded the day with a live auction.
I have been involved with the Relay for 8 years. A couple of years into being involved, I decided that a fashion show would be nice. I approached Dress Barn because Dress Barn is a national sponsor for Relay for Life, and they were very excited to take part. So this is the 4th show.
They're advertising in the skies for people like us. And I miss you when you're around.
Because I thought it was a good way to let people know that just because you have cancer doesn't mean that you can't be a model or something. And it just seemed really fun when it was presented to me. I thought it would be
fun.
And it's what I want to do when I grow up, so I figured, why not?
I decided to become involved with Relay for Life because it's a great cause, raising money for cancer. There's so many people who are having such a hard time, and research will only make the treatments better and hopefully a lot faster. And maybe one day it'll be curable, you know? Just go to the pharmacy, get a pale year all day.
This is my first year. I was diagnosed with cancer in April, so I just wanted to get more involved.
I just thought it was a good idea with everything that I've been through just to help out with something that I can do.
Well, I was diagnosed with cancer in 2006, so I thought it'd be a good idea to help out and get involved and do whatever I can to help raise funds and awareness for cancer research.
All of the models are cancer survivors. They always have been. This year, we have children all with cancer between the ages of 3 and 20. The reason I decided to switch it over to children this year was because I felt that some people thought that cancer only happened to old people. And I really wanted to open up the eyes of people and see that cancer is going on with our young children.
White dress with pink stripes, and then a nice blue pants, hairband, and shirt.
Hi, my name is Mary. I'm wearing a white dress with sparkles on top.
First, hair pants and a silver shirt thing that kind of looks pretty.
I'm wearing the skinny jeans I have on. And then I'm wearing a Moroccan style shirt with some high heels. And then my last outfit is a cute little dress. And plan on rocking that.
I wore a white dress with purple flowers, which is really pretty. And I also wore white jeans and a gray tank top with a cool design shirt. And both outfits were from Chrisley.
I see in these kids that are going to come up here, and I'd like you to see in your own mind's eye some of the things I see were fear, and I saw uncertainty, and I saw pain. And then I began to see and was quite surprised that I saw a lot more things that were much more positive. Strength, faith, hope, power, beauty, love.
The show today was awesome, and all of the models did a really great job, so congrats to everyone. For Flyer News, this is Paige Horner.
Chest thrown and tables toppled, hands on with broken bottles, standing no chance to win, but we're not running, we're not running.
Too often, teen frustration takes the form of physical altercations, and usually these altercations have many consequences.
To be an initial minor altercation into something that turns physical. When that happens, we suspend kids. We put them out of school for usually a fight, if you will, in terms that you would define, would be a five-day suspension. If it does disrupt school, i.e. it's in, during a class, it's a situation where a teacher has to intervene and the fight doesn't stop immediately, we usually will provide criminal charges.
With all these consequences, do students still think school fights are a smart thing to do?
Being in school is stupid, because if you're looking into a colleges, then they won't look at you right.
I think fighting in school is just stupid. If you really can't keep your hands off someone else, just take it somewhere else.
You're going to get caught. You're going to get suspended. It's just not worth it. I think fighting professionally, I think that's actually pretty cool. I wish I had the ability to fight professionally, you know, like UFC or mixed martial arts. So I think that's really cool, and I have a lot of respect for the people that do that.
If the adults and students think school fights are stupid, why do they do it? Better yet, how can they get their frustration and anger out in a positive way? Some students decided on doing MMA, which is a fast-growing sport that sometimes gets higher ratings than football, baseball, and basketball. After I interviewed the students from FHS, I interviewed the local fighters from FHS to see what they think, if they feel the same as the students.
School fights, I don't like them because the kids there, they think they're tough and whatever, and I don't know, I feel like they're trying to prove a point, but fighting only worsens that point. They're only proving that violence is a solution when it's not.
It's a waste of time because, you know, you don't gain anything, you only lose. You think you shouldn't fight, you come here, train, or go in the ring and fight it. Then you're going to win something, you're going to win pride and all. In school or in the streets, only going to lose, you can go to jail, you get in trouble. You're not going to win nothing. Everyone, I'm going to be afraid of.
I haven't gotten a fight outside of a formal setting since I was probably with my brother in like third grade. But no, on a serious note, I don't think fighting is good. Like, it's not productive for society, you know? People don't get by, but
if they all think fighting is bad, why did they personally join?
When I came to see one of my friend's classes and I really liked it, so I asked my parents to so I came for a couple of classes and yeah, it's been good ever since.
I had a friend in college who did wrestling and jiu-jitsu, and then we sparred a couple times and he submitted me, so I wanted to learn jiu-jitsu, and that's what brought me here.
Because at first I thought it was, I just want to try it. But then I really liked it, and I continued doing it now.
Oddly enough, none of the fighters had gotten into an outside brawl, so this made me question, is it the training? So I interviewed the trainer and the owner of the team, and I asked them about their success.
This team, about 7 years ago, we started in a small city in Ludlow, and after a couple of years, our team started to get win a big tournament, like the North American Association, North America Grappling Association. And at this time, we came from Brazil, another BJJ black belt. His name is Pedro Capão Gonzaga, and he came over here to train for me in Ludlow, and he went to the UFC, that's the biggest organization in the world when you talk about mixed martial arts, and he already did 10 fights. He fought for the title against Randy Couture in an awesome fight.
In my school, education, no fight outside, no fight in the college. So my student fight in the college, not good.
Conclusions. Fight happened frequently in school, more than school assemblies. Even though students and administrators think it is stupid, it still happens. On the contrary, though, students who actually fight never do get into fights. To some, their fighting may look barbaric, but it has been said to be safer than football. Because of this, a local school in Massachusetts has an MMA club. If our school has this, fight numbers might go down, since, as we've seen, fighters don't usually get into outside brawls.
TV is like the easiest class ever. It's a big joke. Like, all I do is watch TV and like watch CSI and stuff.
They probably just watch TV all day, which I probably just do at home, so I probably can get an A in that class if I took it.
People think that television production is an easy A. This could not be farther from the truth. TV takes a lot of dedication, commitment, persistence, and hard work. Though it may not seem like it, putting packages together can sometimes be very stressful.
No, check that.
Oh.
Wait, what did we save it under?
I thought we saved it under desktop.
But there's nothing under desktop. Where's our project? No, seriously? Library? No. Rejected? Nope.
Now we're gonna have to get all our stuff again.
We just lost all of our footage. Are you kidding me?
I just said Tanning Texas.
Stop! You're so annoying! No. Just do your work! Do the work! I always do all of it!
You do nothing!
Okay, really? Let's talk about
okay,
all
let's talk
projects.
About a blank script form.
Really?
What do we have
you
on the
you did all this work!
Oh, yeah.
On your last
yeah, go,
project.
Go,
you did
go
nothing!
Look
you
look
did
for
nothing!
It.
You
look
did
for
nothing!
It.
Bye!
Okay, all of
Bye.
All my stuff is on
do
video.
The work yourself!
She almost just hit me in the face.
Stressed.
Why are you
telling me
to shut up? Because it has to go on camera. It has to be like a stressful situation.
I think as you're down here, it is kind of intimidating at first. A lot gets thrown at you, and a lot of times too, it's like, if you screw up something once, everyone kind of jumps all over you. And that's just, it's just how it doesn't matter if it's me or anybody, but it's like, a lot of kids, if they're sensitive to that, they kind of can say, you know what?
I do say that.
Like,
that's what I say. Why is
I
that so? One thing about girls that graduate from FHS TV, if they have nothing else, they have tough skin because we don't pull punches, really, you know? And then we do pick on girls, but the boys are... One of the things that we'll have is I have delegated those two to edit together a 4 or 5 minute package of the assignments from TV1. So gather what you can. If we have our commercials around, little bits and pieces, not whole things, but just, and it can certainly be some of this footage in class, shots of things for the next few weeks, shoot some of it together, and then we can kind of...
Aside from the class, students also have to balance putting together flyer news.
Really start appreciating Flyer News once you work on it, once you know how hard we work and what it and how much work it actually takes to make it.
We start
I think it's done, but what'd you get done so far?
Basically, I have that I've written this.
But we need to get the facts, right?
We need to do facts, we need to do surveys, and we need to find the...
Okay, so should I go right now and take the survey, and then we can hand it to people?
Sure.
I don't know, at lunch?
Sure.
And then we can go
whatever.
Go around
here. As long as we have a couple of them,
yeah.
So we get some variation,
and then
we can do an awesome pie graph or something.
Okay.
Other than that, sounds good.
All right.
And then we can do the voiceover at some point when we get more footage.
They're like, what do? Do you just watch TV? Just watch videos? I'm just like, no, it's actually hard work. And they're like, oh. Whatever.
I think the title of the class kind of is misleading. Like people don't know it's television production. They just think it's like TV, like... TV is
right.
Like,
TV
oh,
right.
You watch videos, you write about
it. It's almost like two separate things. There's like the TV class itself, and then there's all the outside stuff.
Yeah.
People don't realize there's two.
I know that some people are always looking for shoots to do, or they have sports coming up. Tonight would be a great time to work with it. Well, it starts at 6, but it takes a setup right after school.
We will
all be putting together some things for the Bolt Awards here now?
TV is really hard. You have to give a lot of your time and effort, and if you don't have time to give, then I don't suggest taking it. But it's a it's pretty much a full-time job, and it's definitely worth it. You make a lot of new friends. You meet a lot of new people.
Yeah, I think TV is worth taking, and eventually, if you want a career in TV, this is a great place to start.
Welcome to Framingham High School, where teachers and students' lives intersect. But where is there a line between personal and private life, and what are the relationships like between teachers and students here at FHS?
That the reason some teachers are more approachable than others, I mean, of course, a lot has to do with the teacher's personality. And I think a lot has to do with where they've come from and how they've sort of lived their lives. And it depends on the student. I mean, if a student has an interest in a certain subject, most likely they're going to gravitate towards maybe the teacher that teaches that subject. And then from there, they might have a closer relationship with that teacher.
A lot of teachers and students have bonds to the point that they text, or they could be friend requests on Facebook, stuff like that.
I like my students a lot, and I have great relationships with them. And I think a lot of these kids trust me. But I also, you know, like to point out to them that I wouldn't consider the students my friends. You know, I have friends in my personal life, and there's a line there where, you know, I don't cross that line, and nor do I let the students, you know, students don't email me or any of that, unless, of course, it's about school. I'm not on Facebook or any of that stuff. So I think it's real important to keep that personal, professional line.
I think student-teacher relationships vary because some students don't trust their teachers and some teachers don't trust their students, as we can see every day. But then some teachers are really close with one another, but then some teachers also favorite students, which isn't fair with everyone.
Sometimes people almost kind of make an excuse to stay after school because they really like spending time with teachers. And I know how much students and teachers can support each other at times. And I think it's great that a lot of our kids do feel they have that.
Teachers can be friends with like students, but there's like some awkward situation where you just don't like the teacher, so you don't have to be friends with them. It's your choice.
As far as students sharing things with teachers that are personal and teachers sharing things with students that are personal, I think that's a very interesting topic because for students, I think it's important for them to have a trusted relationship with an adult in the building. And if something isn't right or they need help or they need somebody to talk to, they should be able to do that. And if the adult they trust can't help them, that they can at least point them in the right direction to do so. As far as teachers sharing personal things with students, I think that there's a fine line between what you should share and what you shouldn't share. I mean, a lot of students ask me if I have any children, and so I share with them, yes, that I have three daughters, but I may not share with them that they went to the doctors the other day and she has a fever.
With the internet so accessible in today's world, what should teacher and student relationships be online?
Well, I'm friends with my parents on Facebook, so I don't think there's a problem with being friends with your teachers on Facebook. I mean, it's not a big deal. It's not like there's anything that bad on there. So,
interacting with students online, I think, is something that's possible, only with some good parameters in place. For instance, if I have a student who is out for a couple of days and would like to have their homework sent home, they have my school address, and I'm happy to send an email along with what work they missed and an attachment of the homework and to tell them what they need to do in order to get back on track to themselves. I think teachers need to be professional about how they interact with students. The whole issue of Facebook has come up a number of times, and I know there are different teachers that have different spins on this. My particular spin is that teachers should not be friends with students on Facebook. There's a lot of information that's shared that I don't necessarily think students would want teachers to know, and teachers would want students to know. I think it's really important for teachers to keep their personal life separate and online. Kids to have their own space online as well.
We are looking into having an advisory program next year, which would mean that every teacher, every certified teacher, would have a group of about 15, 16 students who they'd see on a daily basis. We're not sure that's going to happen yet, but it's something that was recommended to us after our NEASC visit a couple of years ago as a way to make sure that everyone has someone that they can trust other than their guidance counselor.
able to develop a positive relationship with a teacher is through some basic things: doing their homework, being prepared for class every day, studying for tests and quizzes, and appearing as if they're interested in what the teacher is teaching them in front of the class, and being a good class participant.
HSTV's Save a Jackie visited the lunch workers in the midst of their working day and experienced the lunch making process.
My name is Isabel Fonseca.
It's Catherine Suchler, Richie from Germany.
How do people here know you as? Like, what do they call you?
Lunch ladies. Some call lunch lady, and years ago it was cafeteria girls, right?
Okay. How early do you guys have to wake up in the morning and get here and get everything prepared? Four.
We start 5:30, sometimes 5 o'clock.
Yeah, and what time do you guys set the ovens?
Right when we come in, 5:30.
5:30, and if they ever don't work, what happens?
I'll be in trouble.
You're in trouble.
Oh, we got 6 ovens. Yeah.
Do the lunches you make, do you guys consider kids like food allergies, like peanuts and egg and soy, or do you just make it based on majority?
Mostly majority. We don't use any eggs anyway. Peanut butter, soy, we don't use that anymore.
What's your favorite part about working here? You don't just
stand up to that little pretty. No, I said we like our job. We like our job. We really like it. We do it. I'm 32 years now here.
Mm-hmm.
You 20.
20?
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah. No, we like it. It's, I like it. Yeah. It's a hard. It's hard. Very hard. It's only two of us, right? Oh, we have 5 elementary schools to do.
Oh, so the food you make here isn't just for the high school?
No, it's for the high. We have Hammerby. We have Hammerby. We have Rolfi.
Oh, wow.
We have Charlotte Dunham. We got Stapleton. We make 2,400 meatballs for one meal by hand, right?
Oh, wow. Do the profits that come in from kids, like paying for the lunches, how much of that goes to the school?
I have no idea. No. You have to ask the boss. You know, the boss, it's a budget, or not a big boss. We don't do money. We only do food. But everything is done, you know, the meatballs, everything done from scratch.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, everything is done. We mix our meat, the meat is, and we mix it with the seasoning, and then we do it by hand.
Oh, wow.
A lot of stuff is like macaroni and cheese, everything is done by scratch.
You know? Where do you guys get your supplies?
Oh, sometimes stuff from the state, and sometimes most of the stuff we buy.
Okay.
We have the deliveries. Oh, like wow. The fresh food and everything. We have every day most of it comes in.
Okay.
The food and the salad. So it's always fresh stuff.
If there's ever leftovers, what happens with those?
Not that much leftover. Sometimes it's thrown out. We don't can have we cannot have any leftovers. You know, it's not good. When it's on the line, we have to get rid of it. You see, when it was outside, you know, on the line.
Mm-hmm. And how often does the supply delivery guy come?
Sometimes it depends. It depends what we have.
We got veggies. They deliver
and fresh food.
Okay. Yeah. Oh wow.
They deliver always the bread. The baker comes most 3 times a week.
Yeah.
Is if you ever make all the food for the high school, is that the same menu that
the
kids have?
The high school. Sometimes like the meatballs. The same, macaroni is the same. Like today we have meatloaf, but not for the little kids.
Oh, okay.
The little kids have stuff.
Do the younger elementary schools have like different like fun things? Like I remember in middle school I used to have like shapes of, if it was Valentine's Day, the chicken would be in heart.
We had it no more. We cut that all out. That was all, everything is now wheat.
Oh, okay.
The healthy stuff now, right? We're going to open up. We all get healthy now.
Do you guys ever take the leftovers home?
No, we cannot take anything home.
No?
No food. Not allowed.
Yeah, do you guys have to pay for your lunch?
No.
No?
Because I forgot one lunch. We don't have time sometimes.
We
have a break at night.
What time do you guys usually go home?
1 o'clock.
1 o'clock. And who does the cleanup around the kitchen?
We clean it.
So, what is this you're making?
We're making a new item for the students, chicken burritos.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Not too hard or it's split, you know?
Yeah, that looks good.
Treatment. Yeah, we're going to start, we have a Mexican station coming.
Oh,
so we're going to have beef burritos, chicken burritos, and vegetable burritos.
Oh, wow.
Venga, venga.
Got milk?
Birmingham High School Television Production Program is one of the most prestigious high school television programs in the nation, winning 11 Emmys and counting. This is where it takes place, in the basement of the newly renovated Framingham High School. The state-of-the-art studio has undoubtedly contributed to the television program's success, but FHS-TV has not always been this highly regarded. This is where they started, in a neglected hallway off of the cafeteria. With such meager beginnings, how could FHS-TV and Flyer News have become one of the most successful and popular programs in the Framingham school system? We interviewed Dan Devlin, FHS television production teacher and the man who made this transition happen, to find out.
You know, they were renovating the whole school, and I had been pretty adamant about saying, just leave me alone. Just give me a little bit of money here to redo the studio that I had, and I'm very happy with what I have. I don't want to move. I don't want to be out of here. I like where I am. And finally, they came to me and said, Dan, we'll give you a classroom. And that really changed it for me, because I'd never had a classroom. There was never any time to study and speak and work.
Although initially reluctant to move, Mr. Devlin was won over by Principal Olson.
I mean, upstairs was ridiculously dusty and dirty and not conducive to the news that we could never be where we are now. I was being pig-headed and wanted to be left alone. And they dangled this place in front of me. And Ralph Olson, the principal, then kept saying, you're going to have a palace down there. You're going to have a palace down there. So eventually, yeah, it kind of won me over. Okay, let's have a palace down there. And we saw this room, and it was just a big empty room. No control room, no nothing, no carpet, no nothing. White ceiling. I went up to Ralph screaming that we were supposed to move in on February 11th, and I said, that place is not a TV studio. What you have there is a big room to teach history in, I guess, but it's nowhere close to a TV studio.
Although the move eventually proved beneficial for FHS-TV, it was difficult and even put a temporary stop to Flyer News.
We moved down here in April 2004, and that was our first day. We moved down here, gosh, and some great kids tried to keep Flyer News going. It's the only time that we've ever canceled Flyer News, because we just couldn't broadcast anymore. We were shooting in hallways and things like that, and there was no studio, no nothing, and they kept it going. They were wonderful. It was really nice when we finally got down here. And then they made it work for a Monday in April, and they made the thing work. It was awesome.
Good morning, FHS, and welcome back to Flyer News. I'm Adam Chardoff.
And I'm Ashley Studley. Today is April 11th, a day three with periods running B, A, E, F, G.
Well, I mean, it was Ralph Olson's push to make sure that that we got a nice new school here and things like that. The school was in big trouble. It was in Scholastic and as a result or one resulting the other, the school had fallen apart. It was awful, and no part of the school looked nice. And so who facilitated it? Well, it was Ralph Olson and the building committee. Who moved us down here? I did. I moved it, and Ken installed it and made it work. And I made the place pretty, and he made it functional. Little bits at a time, and then Buildings and Grounds came one day, and myself and five Buildings and Grounds guys loaded up a truck and drove it very slowly down here so that the wires could mostly stay intact and everything. I was very scared that if you sort of took Humpty Dumpty apart, that we wouldn't be able to put it back together again. This was a real fear of mine, that we would never be able to make this place work again. And it does still have two little weird quirks in it that we can't seem to get rid of, and we can't make them happen when there's an expert here. So there are two things about it that still are strange, but who cares? The rest of it's so good.
But it is hard to convince people when there's other things to do, like sports and staying after school with your teachers. But I recommend that you try it, because high school is a land of opportunities. Life as a freshman is pretty great. You can start over like all new. You have new friends, new people to meet, and you can turn your whole career around. If you weren't a good student in middle school, now's the time to change. Nothing is better than starting off with a clean slate right in the beginning and like powering through all your classes and doing well, because that just gives you the confidence boost that you need to last 4 years. And after those 4 years, you're gonna have to look back at all the grades that you've had and apply to college. So think about it this way. High school is like having training wheels for college. How fun is that? Yay! So being a freshman is kind of tough sometimes. The seniors do pick on you a little bit, but like your locker thing, like getting stuffed in lockers, not that any of you have that concern. The lockers here are like little. They're small lockers. So, and don't get rolling backpacks because they don't fit. But being a freshman is a lot of fun. You get to start over new. If you try to sit at a senior table at lunch, you might get salty. It's fine. Brush off your shoulders, move on. There's plenty of tables for everyone. Freshmen and seniors actually have the most school spirit, because you are just happy to be in the high school. But I'm going like with, shirt, oh yeah, like so the bulletin board outside, there's three spaces, so if you guys think there's anything that we need to put up there, any like big announcements, I already put up the freshman boat cruise advertisement and a student committee advertisement, and I had Dylan Richards draw me a bunny rabbit for the Hop in the Spring food drive. So,
decorations.
Yeah, decorations. So we're with the Hollywood theme, but we do not want to spend a lot of money on decorations.
No.
Not Hollywood. That's
I agree.
That's like Easton.
Don't forget to show up.
All four lunches, right?
If I'm in your lunch, I will be like, show up. Why aren't you selling? But yeah, but really get people to go. It's going to be a lot of fun. If they ask if the boat moves, I'm pretty sure it does. It moves, right?
It does, yes. It
does leave the dock.
Yes.
The boat moves.
We go around all of Boston Harbor.
So, and if they complain about the price, just mention, stick it in
tell
there.
Tell them to suck it up.
Tell them, well, like, yeah, we got to rent all these buses, well, and it's like going to be a really fun event.
We get food.
And food is included.
Transportation and dinner.
And transportation and dinner.
And desserts.
It's on a boat. You get all the nice
drinks.
Just bring up the good points, guys.
I didn't come in freshman, yo. This is some good advice. You better listen up right now.
Right,
do your homework. Get it,
do it
done.
Do it. Don't give attitude and don't block the hallways, okay? You don't block the hallways. Just don't do it.
And don't mess with upperclassmen, because you know they be stuffing you in a trash can in 3 seconds.
Great.
Three
two
seconds. 2 seconds.
Two seconds
even. You know if they're that good? 2 seconds.
2 seconds.
Well, here's some advice. One, okay, never backtalk to seniors, no matter what. Two, don't fall for any of the rumors that people try to spread. Obviously, they're not true. And three, don't bring a big backpack. Just don't.
This is a freshman backpack. There's a pocket for everything. There's for your iPod, somewhere around it is for your phone. Your lunch goes in somewhere. And usually freshmen carry absolutely everything, every book they can for every class, even if they don't have the class that day. So, it's, I'm just afraid of opening this. Okay, that's a dead end, there's nothing in there. So, if you ever wanna play keep away with someone's phone or something, just throw it into a freshman backpack, it's done.
Hi, my name is Fernanda Magalies, and I'm here with Ms. Escobar. She's one of the nurses here at Framingham High School, and we're just going to ask her a couple questions.
Okay,
so Ms. Escobar, how long have you been here at Framingham High School?
I have been at Framingham High School since 2003, and so that's almost 6 years.
That's quite exciting. So Ms. Escobar, what is usually the busiest time of day around here? Like when kids come down most to either lay down or because they're tired or because they actually do have an illness?
There's really no rhyme or reason to how busy our health office is. Sometimes when I come in the morning, I do have a lineup outside of my locked door of students wanting to come in for a variety of reasons. And we do see, on average now, anywhere between 100 and 115 students a day that come in to access school health services here in our office. And they come in for a variety of reasons. Sometimes they're just tired early in the morning. Other times they are genuinely sick.
I've actually never went to the nurse to skip class, so
45 times I've been to the nurse, all 45 were for me to get out of class. The times I do get really sick, I just stay in class and I make the teacher feel bad. And every time I go to the nurse, I fall asleep because they're my girls. They let me fall asleep.
In sophomore year, I'll go to the nurse sometimes and like act sick. And they'll be like, oh, can I speak to your mom? I'll say my mom doesn't speak English. So they'll be like, oh, okay then. Just wait for the in the front for your mom and I'll dip.
I've never faked sick and gone home. I've actually been really sick and had to go to the nurse and go home like several times. Freshman year was really bad. I actually had a lot of medical problems freshman year, and that kind of, you know, took away from my wanting to go home from school, because, I mean, when you're sick and you miss a lot of school, it's like, I don't want to skip any. So
we know that adults, such as administrators or teachers, also students come down here to see you guys for whatever the reason, but tell us about some funny stories you've heard or some students' response to an illness or the things they make up to stay down here, or what would you do in worst case scenarios, such as a fire or like the stabbing also that went on here at Framingham High.
That have happened here at the high school. We have taken care of students that have required ambulances to come to the school. They've fallen. They've cut themselves, requiring sutures. We have students with a variety of different allergies, and they've had allergic reactions. And we need to make a telephone call for the ambulances to come. In particular, you brought up the unfortunate stabbing incident that we had several months ago, and there were four of us on that particular day, which was most helpful. It was very distressing to the medical staff here, as well as to the administrative staff, as well as the student body. We did promptly take care of that student, but it involved a concerted effort amongst the four of us to communicate what needed to be taken care of. And the student, thank goodness, was okay. He was med flighted from the field out in front of the school to a Boston area hospital for medical treatment.
That'll be all for today. Thank you for letting us interview you for this. And we'll definitely be down here more often, but not with a fake illness. So,
well, you must come with a pass.
I'll come with a pass.
Come with the pass, and it's been a pleasure. And anyone can come in to see us. You don't have to have a boo-boo. That's my famous little saying. You can come in if there's things that you need to talk about as well. You don't have to have a visible injury in order to come in medical. And it was my pleasure. And speaking of candy, I have a lovely candy for you, because I know that you did a very, very good job and you're hungry, and enjoy it.
All right, well, thank you for having us today, and I'm Fernanda Magalies reporting for Flyer News.
Bye.